I'm Yochai Benkler, for those of you who don't know. I hang around here as faculty. And this is Marvin Amori. And if there is, I don't think there's anyone in the world of whom I can say with greater pride, he was my student here. That's just a fact. No offense to anyone. Marvin probably led the battle on net neutrality from the first day when he led the Comcast suit in the mid-2000s, all the way to the final political battle when he played a central role in conceiving, organizing, pushing, nudging across all sorts of dimensions. And has this is not just me quelling, this is the public record as it stands. Really amazing influence on the way in which we all might have, under different political conditions, experienced the internet. Sopa Pepa, again, absolutely central role as a political legal thinker, and now is the general counsel of Hyperloop, and has decided that instead of speaking, we'll have a conversation. So we will very quickly open this up to questions and answers as the main mode rather than speaking at. And correct me if I'm wrong, you should feel free to ask everything from what on earth does a general counsel do when he gets up in the morning to what is Hyperloop and what specifically will it do on this or that day, to which he will respond, I have no idea. Mm-hmm. But I also, I'd say, invite into thinking about how we think of the world of internet regulation in the next 4 years, which one or two of us may care about, if that's OK. So what is Hyperloop, and why should we care?
So thank you, Yochai. Hyperloop, I think most of you know that a few years ago, Elon Musk proposed a new transportation mode. He essentially was asking, how do you go really, really fast in a way that we haven't done it before? And so the thinking was, well, let's say you put something on wheels and went really fast. Eventually, the wheels would just blow up from centrifugal force. So you'd have to fly or be on magnets or on air. And once you go fast enough, the air pressure will slow you down. So let's get rid of the air pressure. We'll just have a pod on magnets in a tube. And we'll build a tube between two cities. And we'll fire people between them. And so the first example he gave was Los Angeles to San Francisco. His comparison was the high-speed rail that has been proposed for San Francisco to LA. And his proposal was, you know, we could do Hyperloop, and in 35 minutes, you could be door-to-door. Now, after that, he gave the idea. He open-sourced the idea, right? No intellectual property in the idea. And several companies have been born to try to build a Hyperloop. And in my company, has 220 people, three facilities, and sort of an R&D headquarters in LA, and a manufacturing facility and test facility in Las Vegas. And it's an interesting kind of moonshot, right? So you've got one, this private company trying to do something that's like basic infrastructure or invent a new kind of technology. We spend most of our time trying to invent new components and energy systems in order to invent the final product, right? So it's sort of like the space program. And then, you know, we go around the world and we say, hey, you should buy a Hyperloop, Mr. X government official. And then they'll say, gee, how do we regulate this thing? And is it like a train or like a plane? What rules does it fall under? And so so what's a Hyperloop? Why is it interesting? It's interesting because I think it could be, you know, we always make an analogy to the internet. Everyone does, right? Everything's like the next internet. But you know, we talk about it as sort of, you know, connecting cities and connecting sort of neighborhoods in a way that we just haven't been able to do it before, where you could like live in Chicago and commute every day and work in Detroit or vice versa. And even when it comes to, you know, if you were in DC and you wanted to fly to Paris, rather than taaking an hour-long trip to Dulles and then flying to Charles de Gaulle and taking an hour-long trip, you can cut those into 5-minute Hyperloop trips. can change the way freight is distributed. It can really affect the economy. And it's all part of a wave of the future of mobility, drones, self-driving cars, Uber's investing in flying cars. We just sort of see it as sort of, you know, by the time we build one of these things, mobility will be pretty different.
So let me push you a little bit on that last piece.
Yep.
Uber, drones, are all attributes of, let's think of it as artificial intelligence combined with physical control of processes as the critical change. And that's coming on through a process of generations now of increasing computation speed at lower prices. Mm-hmm. Hyperloop sounds like fundamentally the civil engineering component is going to be a major. It's going to take the problem we have with fiber deployment and make it vastly more complex. Mm-hmm. So, for example, when we talk about neighborhoods, the idea of actually. So, what's the technological? You say you're inventing technologies. What's the technological moment that makes this the moment? And what is it connected to that we can imagine is growing fast enough to matter?
Yeah. Okay. So. So the idea of something like a Hyperloop was proposed in the maybe in the 1930s by Goddard, right, rocket scientist. And I'll tell you about a few of the information processing changes that are necessary to do Hyperloop at scale. And then I'll talk about some of the civil engineering. So the concept behind what we're doing is, imagine you're not sending like a giant train from, and I'll just keep using LA to San Francisco. You're not sending a floating train through a tube, because the Hyperloop pod doesn't have an engine. It doesn't need an engine. The motor is essentially magnets on the track that shoot it forward. It's very light. It's almost like a floating bus. Imagine you're shooting buses back and forth. And there are no stops. So if you wanted to stop off in, I don't know, San Jose, there'd be a little turnoff, like a highway overpass, and you'd deposit there. And all the stations can be a lot smaller and spread out through a city because you're having essentially floating buses instead of a giant train. Now, in order to have the kind of throughput you need with all these small pods being fired back and forth, you're not going to be sending them once every 20 minutes on a schedule that you see in the train station. They're going to be fired off once every 30 seconds, almost on demand. And if people are showing up to the Hyperloop station, and the Hyperloops, you know, these buses are taking off back and forth to get the kind of throughput you need that you'd have on a mass transit system, right? You need, and we have an entire team that's just devoted to like the software controls, which relies heavily on artificial intelligence. And just think of it as almost a souped up air traffic control with a lot of autonomous components to it. So the head of our software team is on the Department of Transportation's autonomous advisory regulatory board to try to think through, one, you know, the air traffic control internally, and then how would it plug into an API so that you can order a Hyperloop, land somewhere, and then plug into an Uber and keep going. Right? So the door-to-door piece of the communication would be a lot more complicated if you had to hail a taxi or rent a car on both ends. So that's the software piece of it. And then on the sort of civil engineering hardware side, I don't totally know actually, but I think the examples that I would give, one of our engineers was on the founding team of Tesla, and he helped design the battery for Tesla, and the Hyperloop would be pretty energy intensive, and so it's his job to invent new things. Right, and you see, you read about every day these innovations in batteries, just reducing the price of batteries, making them cheaper, making them easier, and making them lighter, which, you know, has probably been driven by smartphones, and that translates over into making it easier for Tesla and us.
So you talked about talking to government bodies in Europe. Uh-huh. You talked about the issue of essentially a private company doing something that sounds like it's the space program. How do you think about that as somebody who's spent time on thinking of communications as a public utility, or at least as a common carrier, on this trying to harness a public will to do something that is a basic public good, when you find yourself in this company that needs to, on one hand, make all of these basic innovations, think of building basic civil engineering infrastructure, and on the other hand, doing it as an investor-owned company? Are you given up on the state?
I would never let you down like that, Johan. So when I joined Hyperloop One, I joined as assistant general counsel in charge of regulatory and government affairs. I was then promoted to general counsel. And I didn't even realize when I showed up that for a company like Hyperloop One, I think we realized the giant challenge we have ahead of us. And it turns out that governments play a pretty interesting role for the company. One, we have some governments that are investors in the company, right? So SNCF is the French-owned railway. They're an investor in the company. DP World, which is Dubai Ports World, is owned by Dubai. And the strategy of getting governments to invest in the company as investors or sovereign wealth funds is definitely a strategy we have. And our board of directors and our CEO and our CFO, getting the financing and the partnerships with the government is sort of a key thing that we realized we needed to do, just on the stakeholder side. In addition, usually you go to a tech company and the policy guys are not that important, right? I remember when I used to be organizing letters and putting together coalitions, and the policy guys would have to talk to someone on the business side, and there'd be this discussion. You try to figure out a way to get to their CEO and see if he cared. And in this company, because it's a transportation infrastructure company, from the beginning we knew government mattered. They're not only our investors, they're also pretty much our customers. Right, we're going to the Finnish government and meeting with the Minister of Transportation and saying, hey, you should have a Hyperloop. Here's why you should have a Hyperloop in your country. Here's why we should put the first Hyperloop in Finland. And we explain, and it usually has to do with the local geography, but there you have this town called Salo that had the Nokia headquarters. Nokia was acquired by Microsoft, and that didn't go too well. So there's this giant headquarters and all these really smart engineers who might move to Berlin or Paris or somewhere else once their 2-year severance paid by Microsoft through the government is over. So our pitch is, hey, we'll take over the Nokia campus, or something to that effect. We'll hire all these brilliant software engineers to help create our software controls that we need, and we'll build the first test loop in Finland connecting this town Salo to another town 40 miles away. We'll get all the certifications, the safety certification. We'll build up some expertise, suppliers, software developers. There'll be a whole ecosystem. The Silicon Valley of Hyperloop technology will be in Finland. And so that's the pitch we make to one government. We make that pitch to multiple different governments, connecting airports in a way to make sure that as airports become more and more centralized in a few hubs, if you were to connect 2 airports in a country and create a super airport that could compete with the large airport in another country, you sort of have a narrative that you can tell governments. And so, I'm hiring somebody who worked at the State Department and had done a lot of interesting policy work and helped implement the Iran deal, really interesting stuff. I told her, you're going to be helping the business development team, the sales team. Right? So it's kind of an unusual place where the geeky lawyer is actually kind of core to both the investment team and the sales team. And then there's obviously the fact that governments are regulators. And so we can't even try to do what Uber did, which is, hey, we're just putting cars on the street and we're just, we should be unregulated, and then wait for cities to shut them down and then start a fight. We have to actually go in advance and say, hey, we need permission. We want to work with you hand in glove. And there we just copy other smart lawyers, right? We copied Google Fiber. Right? A few years ago, Google asked America, which city wants a gigabit of fiber? Who wants speed? And 1,100 cities applied. Kansas City was chosen. and they sort of negotiated certain terms that made it, you know, they didn't get a subsidy or anything, but they got certain terms to make it more acceptable. And we had something called the Global Challenge, where we asked cities and pretty much anyone from around the world, academic institutions, private companies, hey, tell us why we should put a Hyperloop in your country. We got, you know, hundreds of registrations and about 100 solid applications. We announced 35 semifinalists, but a few of them were submitted by governments. The Florida Department of Transportation submitted a Miami to Orlando route, which is really a great route. The governor of Nevada, along with the congressional delegation, submitted three different routes in Nevada. And so, you know, we're trying to sort of piece something together. And this is actually kind of interesting and ironic point about government. We had always assumed that we would be, that the first Hyperloop would be abroad and we'd be looking abroad, and that the US would be a difficult regulatory environment. And then Donald Trump comes along and says, I've got $1 trillion in infrastructure spending, et cetera, and wants to shake things up. And so people are asking about, you know, maybe we could do one in the US. And we're mainly pulling from the Global Challenge participants to try to figure that out.
Cool. I'm feeling like we should open up the questions.
It.
And if people are too quiet, I'll jump back in with me. Yeah.
The first question
Hold on. Is this on? Good.
Yeah.
First question I wanted to ask, just because it's, you know, it's sort of the conversation that people are having right now towards the sort of high-speed train they're building between Los Angeles and San Francisco, is just sort of the economics of a project like this. It's clearly better in terms of like timing. You know, how does something like this compare to something like the train they're proposing to build between those two cities in terms of like costs?
It's less. So we have a business intelligence team that's mainly, you know, hires from folks across the river, right? Harvard Business School students and Wharton students, and they do all the math. But their math, you know, there are lots of assumptions in it, right? So we're in the middle of inventing some of the technology and trying to figure out how to drive down the costs. And so most transportation projects seem to be overestimated in terms of, or underestimated in terms of the costs. And we're trying not to do that. But, you know, when I asked my engineers, can you build one of these things today? One of them gave me this analogy that I thought was pretty useful. And that is, you know, when Elon Musk invented SpaceX, rockets existed. You could see rockets, they're going into outer space. And, but Elon Musk thought they were, you know, 100 times more expensive than they should have been. And so he tried to figure out ways to innovate and just drive down the costs in order to get into the market. And my engineers assure me that they could build a Hyperloop today. It would just be 100 times too expensive for anyone to want to pay for it or to ride on it. And so a lot of what they're doing is trying to figure out ways to, you know, have cheaper materials that we use around the tube, or less expensive power when it comes to sending it off. So the goal is definitely to be cheaper than high-speed rail. We always say, like, oh, cheaper than high-speed rail and twice the performance. But if we can't get to cheaper than high-speed rail, it's kind of a harder argument to make.
Can I just
throw that was kind of a yeah, please,
because it actually connects
yeah.
to the two. So
yeah,
flight and cars use existing rights of way.
Yep.
High-speed rail is dragging along because of questions of expansions of rights of way, new parts that need to be straightened. You probably need to go over land.
Yes, or underland.
Or underland, yeah. But in any event, you're going to need rights of way from all those people between the points, between Los Angeles and San Francisco, who have less than no interest in being fly under or fly through areas. And that's been a problem certainly for high-speed rail in the Northeast. That's a general counsel question.
Yeah. So two thoughts there. One, we hope that they won't be as disinterested because, you know, we're not loud, we're enclosed, it's a vacuum, sound doesn't travel through a vacuum. So hopefully it won't be quite as big a deal. And we also need a smaller right of way. The way it's usually handled when it comes to trains is you you usually negotiate to put a stop in each town that's mad at you. And so then the train just takes forever because you got to stop all those times. So what we're looking at is, you know, the initial proposal by Elon Musk was just put it on top of a freeway. You already have a right of way there over the freeway. You negotiate with the government. And if you could just have a straight shot kind of on pillars over the freeway, that would be one way of doing it. We're also looking at rights of way that railroads hold or that have been set aside for railroads that have been stalled, you know, around the world. And so we're definitely looking at our plan right now is low hanging fruit, right? We need one or two projects. We don't need we don't have like an apple of our eye project that we need to get and we'll bang our head against the wall as long as it takes. We're sort of putting our chips widely. And if someone steps up and says, we've got a right of way, we've got all the things you need, then that, you know, it's almost like turning the table is what we're trying to do. And so once we have that in place, we're then going to have like a cookbook, right? Apparently this is what they did in telecom. So my CEO had been the president at Cisco. And after the 1996 Telecom Act, which you teach and I studied in your class, Cisco apparently realized they had to sell their routers and other equipment to the competitors because the incumbents wouldn't buy it. So they went around the world with, here's the cookbook, the 1996 Telecom Act. You should implement this, right? The CEO and then the regulatory folks did this. And that's exactly my CEO's model. We come up with the cookbook, essentially, by working hand in hand with the Dubai regulator or the Finland regulator, and we kind of learn, almost like a lean startup-like learning, lean regulatory. And then once we have that cookbook, we then go around and say, this is what we need if you want a Hyperloop. This is the framework.
Interesting.
It's a fun job for a lawyer.
It sounds like. Yeah.
I'm not sure if I'm understanding the way this works correctly. The idea is that one company would build and maintain the infrastructure, and then all the vehicles would be owned by other people and companies and organizations, but they would all have to play nice so you don't have wrecks at 450 miles an hour inside your tubes?
You know, I was unclear on both of them then. So one, I imagine lots of companies sort of being part of the ecosystem to build and operate a Hyperloop system. And two, I would imagine that the control system around the pods would be more sort of controlled and unified under one operator. So we've done a lot of, it's weird kind of creating a company from the ground up, because a few months ago, I wouldn't have been able to tell you this, but we've done a lot of thinking about how would you sell a Hyperloop somewhere? And so, you know, imagine you're just sending someone an IKEA manual. Like how to build a Hyperloop, pretty thick. And you know, it might say, go buy steel on the open market, this much steel. Go buy this much concrete on the open market. All right, go buy 100 pods from Hyperloop One. Go buy, you know, 100 motors from Hyperloop One. And then you'd buy them, they'd be delivered, and then you'd put them together. But there'd be some sort of general contractor that is putting it together, buying all this stuff, and we'd be more like Boeing selling airplanes into the system than the actual organizer of the construction. Then at some point, there's an operator, and that could be the city, that could be the state, that could be a private operator. It's probably not us. We're more on the invention, license IP, sell key components portion of the value chain. Is that useful?
That's very useful, although it raises the question of the Edison company, which is to say Edison first coming up with the light bulb and then realizing that he ended up having to sell the centralized electric grid because you needed the grid in order to connect the light bulb and ended up being, in addition to later on GE, also being Consolidated Edison and all of these things. But the structure was, we think light bulb, but in fact it was the entire grid.
Yeah,
and you describe yourself as now, we're going to be in the light bulb business, but we're going to tell you how to build grids.
Yep.
Edison certainly found that he needed to build grids in several cities before he could get other companies into the grid building business.
We definitely think that we'll be more involved in the building early on. That's right. And maybe we will determine that we should be in the grid building business. I think we've always thought of it as we would learn, again, we'd have almost a cookbook for how to build it. And then we'd be able to provide this cookbook to other contractors who could do the building much more quickly so we could scale quickly. But I mean, GE Ventures is an investor in our company. And we rely on them for a lot of advice when it comes to project finance and project structuring. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so
you can repeat the question because I think people who are listening online didn't.
Underwater is feasible, and the example I used was Providence to New York City with no rights of way issues.
Cool. So when you if you were to come to my office, the R&D headquarters, you would see a drawing that has a water route from San Francisco to LA, and there, we wrote a blog post. We have a marine engineer who's trying to solve this exact issue. And he wrote a blog post about two or three different ways to do it. So one way to do it is you would have a tube underwater that would be on pylons on the continental shelf. With this strategy, you couldn't connect like the US and Europe because it would get way too deep. Right? But on the continental shelf, you could have these pylons. The other example, there are a few other examples. One was one was tunneled, just sort of tunneled under the water, under the ocean shelf. And the third one just seemed really complicated, like floating with multiple different sensors to try to keep it up. And so as I understand it, it's a pretty difficult engineering challenge. Our first routes will not be underwater. Even though the government challenges might be lower, the engineering challenges are pretty high. But the blog post is pretty amazing.
You mentioned in the beginning, when you are talking to folks about this, they're often holding on to either trains or airplanes mm-hmm. as sort of the framework that they're approaching mm-hmm. this different type of transportation. And in Cambridge and many other places, that's a similar issue we have with bicyclists. And sorry, I'm losing my voice. But been part of talks about redoing intersections and trying to think about bikes as something that's independent of both pedestrians and cars. And so I'm just wondering, from your perspective, it's obviously a very different level of technical needs that go into these things. But if you have any feedback for folks who are trying to advocate for better bike legislation in cities like Cambridge.
Okay, got it. It's interesting because when you come from the internet world, and when you think about what is internet law, right? And part of it is what do people at Twitter and Google, et cetera, deal with on a daily basis, and things like copyright and privacy. When it comes to transportation law, one of the main things that people think about, bless you, and focus on is safety. Right? So how do you certify the safety of any new or existing transportation system? And we have an engineer focused entirely on safety standards, et cetera. And part of our story is we think we'll be safer because most fatalities in terms of ground transportation are the result of human error, and we're going to be largely autonomous. At grade crossings, right? So if you're a bicyclist and you have your own lanes and your own sort of world where you're apart, you don't really have crossings with other modes of transportation, which is, I'm guessing, where a lot of the harm can be. Then we also we're also kind of weatherproof if we're enclosed. But I would focus on safety. I'd make that the argument. And to give a recent example, right? I was talking to some folks about Uber's lobbying, and Uber had largely been popular among Republicans and unpopular with Democrats, partly because of their labor issues. And in one state, and probably in many other states, they're flipping it because they focused really heavily on safety and security. Right? Let's make sure that all the Uber drivers have the background checks they need. Would you want your daughter to get into a car with someone who hasn't been vetted? Right? This was their story. And whether it's true or not, it's pretty effective. So I take your question as, how do I be effective? And so I won't comment on the morality of the argument. But I would use safety as a main argument. And my answer to the last question actually reminds me, I should actually tell you what it's like to be at Hyperloop One, like the company itself. It's not at all like a transportation company. It's like a whole bunch of people inventing stuff. It's a whole bunch of people like with big, like, I don't know, engineering textbooks, trying to come up with different different ways to apply physics to the challenges we have at the speeds we have, banking, turning, you know, materials in a space with such low pressure. And it's just a whole bunch of walls covered in equations I don't understand. People, you know, sort of debating over lunch how to do different things. And you know, someone hates somebody else's motor design, and somebody else has a more brilliant idea for it. So it's very much, you know, it's more an R&D company at the moment than even a transportation company.
Can I pause you there? Yeah. Question. How many people in the room are law students thinking about their own future careers? I don't want to ask a question. Okay, enough for me to then ask this question.
Sure.
You've done lots of different things. Mm-hmm. You've been counsel at an advocacy group. Uh-huh. You've been a professor. Uh-huh. You've been...
I had my own firm.
You had your own firm. Yeah. You've been a political organizer. What's a trajectory of building an interesting life that's not traditional for a large law school? And my apologies to those who aren't law students in that, but it looks like half the room is. Mm-hmm. And I bet they'll be interested even if they don't know that they're interested.
Yeah. So when I look at my friends who have had good careers, they're people who took giant risks. And if you go to Harvard Law School, you can actually take good risks, right? I hire lots of lawyers. I've hired like five lawyers in less than a year. Having gone to Harvard Law School makes people think you're probably smart and interesting, and so you can take more risks than other people. And so if I were just to go through like my closest friends in law school, you know, one of them dropped out of a law firm and went to the military, right? He's now a senator, oddly enough. One of them dropped out of a law firm and ended up becoming an FBI agent. One of them, you know, was thinking about his career once. He told me this. He said, I was thinking about my career. And I was like, you know, when it comes down to it, anything you want in life, you actually have to like manage and think through, how do I get from here to there? And he moved to the Middle East where he could get a job in VC, which is what he wanted. A lot of my friends, you know, made a move to nonprofit despite the pay cuts that come with it. Often people would meet me and say, like, oh, you're a lawyer, that sounds boring. And I was like, I have one of the coolest lawyer jobs out there. And I almost always did. But early on it wasn't. Like early on I went to Kirkland & Ellis. It was a great law firm. I had a lot of fun there. But it was just a big, big firm. And then I took a fellowship with you, which my mom thought was crazy, right? I sort of gave up this sensible job to go write some papers with Yochai. I took a fellowship at Georgetown in a clinic, which was also seen as pretty nuts if you're going to be a law professor, as I plan to be, because it was clinical. And so I had to convince people that I wanted to do academics instead. And then I got a professorship, and I deferred for a year to take a job as the general counsel of a small nonprofit named Free Press. And I just thought these people were really smart. And I remember you thought it was a bad idea. Do you remember this?
I don't, but I trust you. That sounds right.
Yeah. I mean, it was actually a bad idea. No one had heard of these guys. And that was when I handled the Comcast BitTorrent case.
Which turned out not to be a bad idea.
It turned out to work out well for me. And I also worked on the Obama campaign, and it was a fun year. And so I think a lot of people are just kind of not willing to take a risk. And I just wanted to get into telecom. That's what I wanted to do. And it took a few years to get there. And then I kind of had my break with Comcast. But what I see is, you know, if you're one of those people who like complains about law school, those people end up complaining forever about their job, even though they could easily change it. So I don't know. Just have a positive attitude. And
you don't enjoy your career in law, it's your fault. That's the message.
100%. That is my message. So someone in this room, unless like a tragedy befalls you, or like you could probably take a risk and end up exactly where you want to be. All my friends who actually made a move to where they wanted to be ended up there.
Okay. Questions on that?
Is that too harsh?
That's very harsh, but you're in a position to say it.
All right, fine.
So that's okay. It's legitimate. Right. You've certainly taken risks and done many different things over time. You're in a position to be entitled to say it.
But I would say most of my friends have done the same thing. Most of my friends who are happy at one, really happy with their jobs and their careers, made that kind of move. And so I was here for my 10-year reunion. And the 10-year reunion was really funny. We were kind of in a room like this. It might have even been this room. And TJ Duane, who was one of my classmates, was sitting here and going around the room asking people what they had done since going to law school. And there was sort of a similar trajectory for some people, which was graduated from law school, went to a big firm in New York, hated it, left, did something they loved. Right? It was like repeated. It was just everyone had that kind of path. And the people who everyone seemed pretty happy. No one said they were unhappy. But the people who seemed happiest had taken a sort of risk that you wouldn't expect.
So that's an even stronger statement.
No,
that's okay. Just clarifying.
Okay.
Pushback, comments, or shifting back to Hyperloop One or other things? Yeah, there's a question there in the back.
Do you have somebody at the company doing environmental impact kind of assessment, whether to do with emissions or infrastructure? Where does that figure in? And also, I was just curious if you had buy-in from the aviation industry in any form, or whether you predict they'll see this as an enormous threat to their industry. And
so we do not have someone full time at the company doing the environmental assessments. We've used outside law firms for that. So on my team internally, I'll tell you who I have on my team internally. So I have an IP lawyer who does all of our patents and trademarks and things like that. Who owns the word Hyperloop is actually kind of a contentious point, oddly enough. So, and then we have a lawyer who focuses on contracts. Right? It's kind of unusual how many contracts we need in our company compared to, say, a software company. Right? If you were a developer or a software developer, you would write something up, I guess, and then you'd be able to push it to the web, and you wouldn't need to do anything else. Here, they design something on their computers, like a design of some sort, and then we've got to usually pay some vendor to make the device, and then we test the device, then we send it back, and if the device isn't made well or not made quickly enough, there are issues, right? So there's all these contracts we have, and I've got a poor, overworked chap just working on all the contracts. Then I've got two people focused on financings, because this is pretty capital intensive. One on getting money into the company, corporate financings. So those are, you know, the people who go to, you know, pretty much every general counsel seems to have a corporate financing background and worked at Fenwick or Wilson Sonsini or Gunderson or Cooley. There's just a few firms that are in all the deals. And I've got three people from Gunderson that I hired who all are sort of trained in that way. And then we've got a project finance person. And project finance is something I didn't know anything about in law school or until recently. But that's sort of financing big projects like solar farms, oil pipelines, airports, and that's usually done with tons of bank debt from particular bankers who want a really long-term horizon and get paid back based on 50 years of revenue. So I've got one of those. So those are the lawyers on the team plus two political folks. The former, the most recent chief of staff of the Department of Transportation. I just hired him on to join our team and to help us think through all the regulatory issues. But a lot of the other stuff we do out house, right? Not in house, like litigation. I don't have a litigation lawyer on staff yet, and a whole bunch of other things. I just have outside lawyers for employment, real estate, and then eventually, if we get big enough, I'll hire someone in. As for the aviation industry, that's a great question. I don't totally know. I've met with a few folks from a few of the airlines. I think we haven't proven enough for them to focus on us.
Your hand up before.
But one day they will focus on us, and then I will charm them.
So thank you so much for your talk. So I'm a 1L, and I know I recognize a few other 1Ls in the room as well who are currently thinking about career plans. And I know a lot of us, myself included, are seriously considering, really want to go into a technology company that's really on the cutting edge, as Hyperloop is. And so I was just wondering, like, what your career advice would be to someone who's just starting out. I mean, the reality is I'm also supposed to go to big law firms or go to government and that kind of thing. But your advice on how to get to basically where you are and what things that you would do differently, perhaps, if you had a chance to start again.
Okay, sounds good. So I realize I gave a harsh answer. I'm going to give the same answer in the exact opposite light, hopefully, which is I now remember what it was like as a 1L or a 2L, and you're wondering what your career will be like and if you'll have a good career, and it's kind of stressful. The whole, it's almost like you're overwhelmed with options, and you want to make sure you choose the right one. And what I meant with my previous answer is, don't worry about it too much. Take a risk, go for it, and if it doesn't work, you'll be okay. Even when I offer jobs to people, I'm like, look, if the company goes under in 2 years or something because something goes wrong, you'll be able to get a job. Look at your resume. I think you can probably take risks. So to be sort of more specific, take risks and don't worry about it is the more general answer. And part of that general answer is, obviously do something that you really love doing. Right? I had to find someone who just loved contracts. Right? I don't love contracts. This guy Han loves contracts, loves tech transactions, loves the IP portions of the contracts. Laura on my team loves doing equity financings, loves living in an Excel doc with cap tables, loves this. And if you love doing it, you'll be really good at it, and someone will want to hire you to do that. So more specifically, I actually began at a law firm. And when I went to Kirkland & Ellis, it was always ranked number one in training or top five in training. And I don't really know if their training programs taught me all that much. Everyone was just so busy that work was pushed down, and I got to do a lot of work. And I worked with really smart people, and I felt like I learned a lot at Kirkland & Ellis. And then when I spent 2 years at Georgetown as part of a clinic there, they have a whole bunch of clinics at Georgetown, and this was kind of the cyber law clinic, but more like TV and communications law as well. Angela Campbell's shop. One of the shops next door was David Vladek. And David Vladek is just amazing lawyer. And just sort of watching him and working with him occasionally, I got to learn a lot. So I would pick firms where it's hard to tell when you're a 1L or 2L, what firm you should be at. They all seem the same kind of. They all say the same thing. Even when they pitch me to hire them, as outside counsel, they say the same thing. So it's kind of hard to pick. You might want to think about what lawyers you also would want to work under. You sort of read about and try to think through. It's a lot easier for appellate lawyers are pretty well known. Some corporate lawyers are pretty well known. So just I would think about who you'd want to work under. And then I think I named a whole bunch of firms that tend to do a lot of startup work. Gunderson Dettmer is a good firm. Seems like lots of general counsels worked at Gunderson Dettmer. They're outside general counsel to a whole bunch of small startups. And if I were the CEO of a small company and you were at Gunderson Dettmer and you were doing all my work and I was paying $400 an hour for you and I could hire you at a cheaper rate to do the same exact work in-house, that's what happens all the time. And Gunderson people are brought in. Wilson Sonsini is a great firm. The firms I mentioned, Cooley, Goodwin Procter is a really good startup firm. I would go to a firm like that, where you're going to be doing startup work for startups, and you're going to be in the scene, and everyone will know you. Right? If you were interested in doing internet policy, sort of internet freedom work, et cetera, I'd recommend going to EFF, going to New America in DC, going to Free Press, where I worked. EFF is the Electronic Frontier Foundation. And these guys have pretty amazing lawyers, really amazing talent, very influential. And you'll get far more substantive work there as a young lawyer than maybe anywhere else. But I don't even use Gunderson, but I steal all of their lawyers. So and I probably owe them. So if anyone wants to be introduced to my favorite partner at Gunderson, let me know. And I'll just introduce you to him as a favor to him. He'll get 20 Harvard Law students emailing him saying, Marvin says you're awesome. So his name is Ward Breeze, if this is being recorded. sorry, I stole all your good lawyers recently. So.
Wow, lots of questions. Yeah.
Yeah, so I feel in this country we usually think of our transportation systems as primarily government-run, and so I'm just wondering kind of what you foresee the government or the public's role in with Hyperloop going forward in terms of, you know, delegating, operating, maintaining, and financing of the infrastructure.
So one of the things that we're doing, which is kind of interesting, is that we're trying to do everything at once. So the levitation team is trying to invent the levitation that's really energy efficient and energy elegant and that works really well. The
Can I just say,
yeah,
the coolest sentence, the levitation team is trying, yeah, to just forget about everything else.
The propulsion team.
Keep going.
The propulsion team is, you know, trying to build the propulsion system. The tube team is trying to build an efficient tube. The braking team, the energy team. So all the teams are trying to invent all this stuff immediately. And while that's going on, the government and regulatory and legal team is trying to come up with the legal framework and how to interact with governments. And at the same time, the business development team is going around trying to sell a Hyperloop. And one of the things that's interesting is they're all kind of, they're all interrelated. So when we talk to governments about what their appetite is, what they'd want to do, and, you know, in some places, the idea is the more private money, the more private operation, the better. And in other places, the notion is, of course, this is a government-run function. And it's kind of fascinating because we're talking to customers as we're trying to invent the thing. And a lot of the engineers on our team have worked on things where they've invented something and then tried to sell it and no one wanted it. And so we're trying to avoid that. And so if a government came to us and said, we want to operate it and we want to be involved in these ways, we would be amenable to it. Right? Then kind of everything kind of pushes back, though, because let's say that Dubai government said, hey, we want to route this long, whatever that is, 50 miles. It's not going to go 700 miles an hour if it's a pretty short route. It's going to be much slower, just because you don't need to be that fast anyway. It doesn't save you a lot of time and just adds way too much complexity and cost for such a small route. So if you're going to have a lower speed, it then changes every piece of the engineering, right? The levitation might be different. The propulsion might be different. You might have already, if you're the lawyer who sees all the contracts, you might have already bought too many motors or certain things that we're testing that we don't need anymore, right? So a long way of saying, I envision the government to be deeply involved. I envision them to be operating in most regions, but we're not dead set on, you know, not having private partners operate.
There was a hand up there in the back.
By the way, I apologize for my long answers. I feel that my, you know, if you need me to shorten them, just let me know.
You kind of touched on this in the last question, but I was wondering if you could talk a bit more about the really long-term vision for Hyperloop, like maybe 50 years out.
Yeah.
I don't know how much of that conversation you have on a day-to-day basis, and I imagine it changes a lot, but if you could just provide some insight, that'd be great.
Great. So you know, I think the initial routes, right, are going to be sort of short routes that are manageable, that are between high traffic sites, maybe within a city or connecting airports or, you know, connecting two cities that are nearby. You know, I mean, the long-term vision is, you know, just sort of nations crisscrossed with Hyperloops. And people could live in whatever, Pittsburgh, and work in Chicago, and it'd be a simple commute. It wouldn't be that long. That's you know, or people would live in D.C., or no, they'd live in New York and they'd commute to D.C., right? Including Melania, right? That'd be really convenient. And, you know, there's some things that, you know, it's hard to predict.
That's your 50-year projection?
You know, I do think it'll be eight rough years. And so there are certain, you know, imagine, you know, even the route from LA to New York, I think will be a more manageable, doable route. And so then let's say you have, so I'm just talking about sort of connecting point-to-point cities. I think you then have cities where, you know, it's nothing but an industrial town and everyone lives 20 minutes away, right? You could set up just an industrial town outside of Chicago. That's like an easy commute for everyone, rather than have people live and work in the same place. You know, some of the newest towns in America are kind of quirky, right? There's a new town called The Villages in Florida. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's bigger than Charlotte. It's like a brand new town. And it's like a retirement community. It's very, very, very planned. And, you know, if there are towns like that that are going to be sort of sprouted up, they're pretty homogenous towns, actually. And you could connect them to different regions. You could end up with sort of rethinking how cities are structured. It could be more diverse. It could be less diverse. More diverse sounds more favorable to me. I guess I'm not good at the vision is hard to predict, right? It's almost like when Steve Jobs held up the iPhone and said, you know, here's this awesome thing. It's an MP3 player and a phone and a browser in one. You couldn't have really predicted Uber. Right? That was kind of an unlikely prediction. So it's not totally clear to me what will happen in 50 years, other than hopefully there are Hyperloops everywhere connecting lots of cities to each other.
Right. I think this may be, unless it's a very short one, this may be the last.
Okay.
I had a question about the sort of long-term consumer impact of something like this. In particular, you know, because like the idea of being able to get from like LA to San Francisco in 30 minutes sounds wonderful, but it also sounds like the kind of thing that would be, you know, probably fairly expensive. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so for people who could afford to buy that ticket, they could do that. And for everyone else, they would take, you know, the current options. Mm-hmm. And so part of what it sounded like you were saying was, you know, a pitch to governments to take taxpayer money in sort of helping to build this, you know, high speed option that would be available for people who can afford it. So my question is, you know, when you talk to governments, how are you pitching this as, you know, sort of a part of a larger transportation ecosystem that doesn't take money away from other areas where, you know, someone who can't afford a $100 one-way ticket can still, you know, get to work through other forms of public transportation.
Got it. I guess we give them two answers. Answer number one, you could work in San Francisco, but live what would now be an hour and a half away or 10 minutes away, where the housing would be a ton cheaper, right? So if you think of how expensive property's gotten in a lot of our major cities, you know, and there's all this traffic to get in, you could really reduce a lot of that. And our MOU with Moscow was to build a sort of new Moscow where people could just hyperloop in and out. That's kind of stalled at the moment, but that's the idea. Property and congestion are really bad in a city. You could create a satellite city, like a new kind of suburb. So that's one, a lot cheaper housing. Two, in terms of pricing, we've talked about it as being competitive with existing options. And so think of a ticket costing $20, not $100. Right? The idea isn't to be... It is to be high volume, high traffic, low price.
We probably have time for one more if people want. Yeah.
I was curious what kind of time frame you're thinking of, like how immediate in the future is like the first Hyperloop going to be? Like how, I know there's a lot of variables to that, but what's the internal prediction of the implementation plan?
Our target is 2021. Right? And it would be a short track, you know, it'd be short, 20 to 30 miles.
Wow, that was such a short turnaround. We could, okay. Three things. One, more of innovation is moving into the real material world from the information and communications world, and seeing you move in that way is part of it. Two and three are really two things for the students here. I look at you, I listen to you, and I say, this institution gives you enormous power, which you can use, based on Marvin's story, at least in two valuable ways. One is doing something for the public, not just for yourself. And the other is using the immense privilege that it gives you to take risks with your life and be interesting, rather than to play it safe. It's a great pleasure to listen to the General Counsel of Hyperloop One, Marvin Amori, and to have you back here. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Yochai.